So,
here we go.
Welcome, everybody. We are really glad that you're here. This is a really important issue, and we know there's lots of things going on in town tonight. We're concerned about that. But since it's being filmed, it'll go be played over and over and over again on DCTV, and it'll go statewide. And this is a really, really important issue that we're here to talk about. So this is sponsored by the Thurmaston Conservation Commission. If you can help us out, it does cost us to have it filmed. So there's a donation jar out there. And this is Margaret Skinner, and she's here from the University of Vermont, entomologist. And I'm going to just turn it over to you.
Great, thank you. I'd like to do it from here, I guess. Thank you all for coming. I'd like to also introduce Don Toby. He drove down with me today, partly because I just came back from South Korea, actually, for doing some research over there. And I didn't want to fall asleep on the way home, so. And he has worked on this project as well, and can certainly add things as we're going along. What I really like out of presentations is for you to interrupt me at any time. If I'm talking too fast or things don't make sense, feel free to interrupt. Okay, Hemlock Woolly Adelgid, a hard nut to crack. We at the Entomology Lab have been working on Hemlock Woolly Adelgid in one way or another for probably 15 years, long before it ever came to Vermont, because we thought the chance of it coming to here was very likely, and we better start working on it. It is such a hard insect to work on. It is so unpredictable in so many ways, and that's why I think it's such a hard nut to crack. And I'm going to explain some of the reasons why that is. Some of the things I'm going to talk about are basic information about Hemlock Woolly Adelgid, which some of you may know because you've been working on it or looking for it before. Some of it is more scientific because that's how you know what the answers are for what we're finding. Okay, let me see if I got this all right. Yes! Okay, I'm from the Entomology Research Laboratory, which is located a little bit off campus in Burlington. We're a team of four senior scientists, several technicians, and graduate students. We're mostly funded by external sources, not by the University of Vermont. And so, sort of just like you here, we have to go where the problems are and where the funding is, for better or worse. So what you see here is we don't just work on Hemlock Woolly Adelgid, though sometimes it would be nice if we could really focus on one thing. We work on a lot of different kinds of things in lots of different settings. One of the areas that we work with is an insect called western flower thrips in greenhouses, probably the number one pest in greenhouses, a pest for which they apply large amount, or used to apply large amounts of chemical pesticides, and those pesticides aren't working so well anymore. And a lot of the work that we're doing with fungi and biological control is really helping growers get off that pesticide treadmill, which is really exciting. The greenhouse industry is really important to Vermont. It provides a sort of diversification for small farmers. So we like working on that. But we also have a strong interest and motivation to work on forests, and here we have, these are sort of the primary insects that we've been working on in terms of exotic pests primarily, hemlock woolly adelgid, Asian longhorn beetle, and elongate hemlock scale, which is now found in your area, sort of a somewhat new introduction, I guess. One primary area of research is insect killing fungi. Have you heard of insect killing fungi before?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes, okay. So just in case you didn't know, they're fungi that specifically attack insects. They don't attack people or plants. It's just the nature of that little beast. And it's an underutilized resource in terms of biological control. And we have worked in various ways to try and develop it more into a viable
option for growers and foresters, hopefully. Okay, so what is Hemlock Woolly Adelgid? Again, a lot of you may know that. This is the scientific name. It's a sap sucker, similar to aphids, scales, and whiteflies. And though you don't really see it when you're looking at it, it has a very, very long, small stylet that it sticks into the twig, and with that stylet, it sucks up the sap. It is still amazing to me that such a small insect can cause so much damage to such a large tree. You can sort of understand something like Asian longhorn beetle, those are big insects, but to think that something so small can have such an impact that it can actually kill the tree, not because of diseases that it's transmitting, but just by the action of sucking the life right out of it. Okay, it's an exotic pest, and so it lacks the native natural enemies and control agents. And unlike some other pests that come in as exotics, these other natural enemies don't, the native ones don't seem to have taken over, so it continues to be a problem. It's tiny, it's so hard to find, that's why it often goes undetected for a long time. It's really hard to study for that same reason. It infests really tall trees, which makes it really hard to try and control it. Even whether you're trying to do it in an urban setting, but obviously in a forest, to try and do some kind of spray is really not operational. It has two generations a year, and it produces this woolly covering over, which provides even more protection against both predators and parasites, but also chemical pesticides. Okay, short history, just so you know this. It's a host. Its hosts are eastern and Carolina hemlock. That's sort of good in that it's unlike the Asian longhorn beetle that has a broad host range. It's only focused on hemlock. Sort of also similar to emerald ash borer. That's the only good thing about hemlock woolly adelgid, I guess. introduced accidentally in the 1920s on the West Coast, 1950s, it was found on the East Coast. I don't really know how it got here, but anyway, it got here. 2007, it was first detected in Vermont. The thing that always amazed me, people have been studying it to some extent down in the more southern areas, where just huge amounts of damage had occurred and death of trees. I couldn't understand why people weren't really studying it when they first started finding it causing damage. I think that was kind of, I wish they had started earlier. But anyway, the important thing to realize, this green area is all the area, the natural area where hemlock occurs. The yellow areas are new infestations in the last few years. This was as of 2012. So you can see that's Bennington County there. That's when that was found. My sense is maybe it's a little bit farther south, north, moving up north this way, but I'm not sure. I couldn't find a map any more recent than 2012.
That's the most recent federal map. It was found last winter in town of Springfield, which is Windsor County.
Okay, so creeping up, I think there's every reason to believe that it will continue to move north and affect most of Vermont.
Could you tell us what the brown, yellow, and green
areas are? Yeah, sorry. So white areas are uninfested. In the brownish area is all the infested areas.
What about the green and the yellow?
So the green is the area where hemlock occurs naturally. So all theoretically, if hemlock woolly adelgid could and would and wanted to, it could infest this whole area. And I think it's probably fairly likely that it could in the future. Okay?
Yeah, it looks like the yellow county that's infested, not Bennington.
Well, Bennington is over here, and that's yellow, and that means it was newly infested in 2012. What that really means is it was first detected. That just because it's not detected doesn't mean it's not there. But what this does show is that it's new infestations are continually being found farther north from the existing range or area of infestation.
I'm new to
okay.
coming up from Florida, so, and we don't have any moose down there.
And no moose? No.
Florida, you never know. But is this going to be another problem for the moose?
No. It only feeds on eastern and Carolina hemlock trees.
And moose don't have anything to do with hemlock.
Well, the other thing is hemlock doesn't occur down in Florida.
No, I mean here.
He means
sorry.
Moose habitat is primarily spruce fir. And although you'll find moose living where there's hemlock. But...
Yeah, our concern here would be the impact it'll have on deer habitat.
Yeah, deer winter, hemlock is very important for white-tailed deer wintering habitat, so it could affect them if there's a loss of hemlock. Hemlock is also a tree that grows along streams and brooks in the riparian zone. It's very important in shading the streams and brooks. Which cools the water and maintains good trout habitat and countless other wildlife species. So if it disappears from the riparian zone along your rivers and streams, that'll be a very bad thing as well.
We'll lose it.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, so why is HWA important? So Don has talked about some of those. So it's the seventh most abundant tree in Vermont. So one out of 10 trees in Vermont is a hemlock. So that's pretty important when you think of the hemlock resource. Just in comparison, every third tree in Vermont is a maple tree. So it's right up there in terms of importance. One other thing that I saw as I was preparing this is that Vermont, I believe, is the fourth most forested state when you compare it with its total area. Obviously, we're small, but we have a lot of forested area compared to, you know, obviously there's huge areas in other states that are forested. But in terms of our proportion of land, our forest land is really important to us. And in terms of the United States, we're right up there in terms of forest. So that's another reason why it's, you know, our forests, we need to protect them. Okay, so Don talked about the riparian zones. All of you down here, having dealt with some flooding, certainly realize how important having some trees to protect the riverbanks are from erosion. Critical habitat for all sorts of wildlife, birds, as well as mammals. And it's an important tree species for pulp and lumber, etc. And it's one of the reasons it's really good is that it is a shade-tolerant tree, so that even if there's a shady canopy over it, it can still grow and continue to mature. And that helps in terms of preventing other invasives from invasive plants from getting in. Okay. All right, so I don't want to go into a whole lot of this, but some of you actually do scouting, yes, for hemlock woolly adelgid. Okay, so some of this you may already know, but I think it's good just to go over it so that you see what some of these things look like. So when you're out looking at your branches with your hand lens, you know what you're looking at. One of the other things that's really important about pest management is you've got to know the life cycle to be able to know what it's doing, when it's doing it, and hopefully find a weak link for trying to manage it. And I say manage, not control, because there's no such thing as controlling an insect. That's what I was taught by my PhD professor. Don't ever use control, because it's not possible. God love those insects. Okay, so I think I'll start down with the egg stage. So in the early spring of the year, right around in here, the adults from the fall lay eggs, and here they are, there's the eggs, and you can just barely see the insect underneath there. And when you get your hand lens out and start looking on underneath there, you can see the thing moving around. You can oftentimes see little droplets of liquid that it's exuding. So the eggs are all nicely hidden underneath that woolly mass. Those eggs hatch right around in here, and they turn into crawlers. That's the only stage that is actually mobile, self-mobile. So they crawl all over and pretty fast. They're really tiny, but you can see them with a hand lens. And they're crawling all over the place, trying to find a good place to eat. So when they find just the right succulent needle, they stick in their stylet, which you saw before, and then they settle down. And then they, and this is not quite in order, but then they settle. And so some people, I'm not going to use the fancy scientific names. Basically, they're called settles. So they've settled, and they're going to stay there for the rest of their life. They really like new growth on hemlock because it's tender and succulent, like a good piece of steak. So initially, when they go from this crawler stage, they are little black tiny dots. And they start, over time, developing this little halo of hairs around it, sort of silvery hairs. You can see right there. Over time, it gets more and more. They get more and more longer hairs. And then ultimately, they make this the woolly mass. And then they lay the eggs and do it again. There is this one funny little stage where some of them will be males. Most of them are females. But anyway, but there is this odd little period of time when a few males are produced, and they are winged ones. All these others, the females, have no wings. So one of the things to keep in mind when I think Don was talking about the whole issue of dispersal with me earlier today, and he was talking about bird flyways. And one of the thoughts is that birds serve as a way of transporting insects from this insect from tree to tree, which would make sense, especially in the crawler stage. They crawl onto the bird, and then the bird moves somewhere else. Anyway, so there is this one little stage that where there's a male, but other than that, it's female. So they go through this stage fairly quickly, over 2 or 3 months, and then that adult stage lays eggs again, and then it goes through this whole period over the summer and the winter, and then starts over with eggs, etc. That's really important, and you'll see why a little bit later on. Okay, in terms of how the population keeps increasing.
Just make a lot of note that winged stage, the males that go to spruce, they just die. That's a generation that doesn't complete its life cycle. Perhaps in its native country, it would do something on the spruce.
Martin? Yeah, but if there aren't any females there, then
yeah.
Let's face it, you can't do what up somewhere around.
Well, what function does it serve then?
I don't think people really know that.
They just sort of go off and
I really don't know.
What I've always heard is that the others that don't differentiate into males have parthenogenic reproduction, and so there isn't an opportunity for a lot of genetic material to be exchanged, which is a bad thing from their point of view in terms of resilience and so forth. And that having this option where they can go off to an alternate host allows them to have sexual reproduction, which allows for exchange of genetic
Except
material.
There's no females at Spruce, so I don't know what they're going there for.
Well, I was under the impression that there were both male and females that had the wings.
Only the males, as far as I know, are winged. Well, anyway, I think at this point it's not perceived as a really important component. Though I think in terms of the whole, when he talked about parthenogenesis, basically that means that the female can produce eggs and young without mating with a male. And that's very common among aphids and some other sucking insects. Though theoretically it should be a problem in terms of their ability to adapt genetically, they seem to be doing okay. So there may be some mating going on the tree, which provides some diversification. But anyway, okay, factors that affect hemlock woolly adelgid. When we first started working on hemlock woolly adelgid, we said to ourselves, okay, we're up in Vermont, it's cold up here. It's colder than down in Connecticut, where, I don't know if you've seen the forests in Connecticut, but when I saw the kind of decimation that has occurred from hemlock woolly adelgid, it blew my mind. It has changed the ecosystem in these suburban kind of areas, and forested areas too, but you could see these suburban, beautiful homes that had been built within a hemlock forest for privacy. They had no more privacy anymore because all the hemlocks around them had died. And it just incredible. So we said to ourselves, huh, geez, it's really bad down there. What's going to happen when hemlock woolly adelgid comes up here? Maybe cold will stop it. Maybe it cannot survive our cold weather. So we did some tests, admittedly, primarily in the laboratory, but also some in field conditions. And what we found was, and this will make you sort of happy, 95% mortality occurred among hemlock, among the adelgids after exposure to minus 22 degrees Fahrenheit. Well, we get minus 22 sometimes. So 60% mortality at minus 13. At minus 13, we always get that. You might say, what might you think when we're looking at that? What are some other issues that you might want to consider in a forested environment that may make this as a lab study incomplete in terms of representing what's happening with hemlock woolly adelgid?
Well, it would be the time that it was, the length of time that it was minus 22.
Exactly. So we did do it, I'm not going to dwell on this, we did some studies to look at exposure for 1 hour, 3 hours, 5 hours, 24 hours, etc. So we did look at that. Anything else that comes to mind for you?
So what was the result with different times?
Well, I think the 95% mortality was maybe after 24 hours. But there were a couple of things that we found. One is they became less cold tolerant as the season progressed. So by February and March, they were getting ready to go because it was starting, we were collecting insects from down in Massachusetts because we didn't have any here. So they were already coming out of any sort of dormancy or any protection that they might have had internally. So, which, and that occurs here too, that, you know, if you get a cold snap late in the season, that might be good in terms of reducing the population. We also, but one of the other issues is, just because we found this under lab conditions, we all know that what happened, you know, the conditions in the forest is really different. You know, there's lots of needles around, there's the humidity and the warmth from the river that they might be near. So there's lots of other factors that sort of moderate these results. But it does show that cold temperatures does have an impact. So that's good. All right, cool, great. There has been a lot of research on various exotic predators, mostly beetles, and here are some examples of them. There are different kinds of lady beetles, most of them. To produce these, it probably costs 75 cents a beetle, something like that, maybe more. Very, very, very expensive. Okay. There also are several native predatory insects. Obviously, they haven't been doing their job yet, or else we wouldn't have such a problem. And then there are several insect-killing fungi. Thing to remember, there's no silver bullet. We all like a simple answer. For hemlock woolly adelgid, I don't believe that's going to be the case. I don't think one thing is going to solve the problem. Okay, I want to just go through how insect-killing fungi work, because it's pretty darn cool. And that's what makes them so cost-effective. So first of all, Fungi infect insects. They don't infect plants or humans. So it only theoretically takes one spore, one little microscopic spore that grabs up. I'm going to show, I'm going to do this again. I did this one other time. Stand up, Don. Okay, this is a spore, okay? It grabs. They don't do it that hard, so otherwise I might do it hard. So it touches on there, and it has stuff around the surface, and it sticks on there. It says, it doesn't have a nose really, but it's the equivalent of a nose. It says,
feels pretty good.
Yeah. And so it starts producing what is called a penetration pig. And you can sort of see the spore germinates. It says, okay, I'm liking this. So the spore germinates, and then it with great pressure, and I don't know how it works, but it's huge pressure. It puts on the insect. This is, well, pretending that's an insect. And it pushes inside, and it also produces enzymes that breaks down the surface of the insect that usually is pretty tough, and it pushes its way inside, and you can see it's pushing in there. Once it gets inside, it's like, all right, I got all this inside guts and stuff to feed on. It starts making all sorts of mycelia. You've seen mycelia on bread when bread, mold is a kind of fungus. So it starts growing these things inside the insect, and then once it's eaten everything out, says, okay, I gotta go and find somebody else. So it comes back out, produces spores, and starts all over again. The nice thing about some fungi, and you can see all these examples, and one of the reasons I wanted to show this to you, is in your travels, you may find insects that look like this. This is an earwig. This is an aphid. This is a grub that's often found in the soil. If you find those things, send them up to us. You never know what it may provide. I think probably the very best example of the potential of insect-killing fungi is right here, and that's with gypsy moth. You familiar with gypsy moth, everybody? I studied gypsy moth as a master's student, and we worked on parasites of gypsy moth, and it was all very interesting, and we saw lots of parasites, and they sometimes worked okay, but they never held it in check. And every 5 to 8 years, we would get an outbreak. People would get excited, and they would spray Bacillus thuringiensis, usually, which is okay, but it's expensive, et cetera, et cetera. And then, all of a sudden, in 1990, all these gypsy moths started dying. They were getting all geared up for a big outbreak. They all started dying. And they found that it was a fungus inside, which was called Entomophaga myrmica. It had originally come from Japan. It had been released as a biological control agent many, many years before. They couldn't find it. It didn't seem to work, so they gave up on it. Lo and behold, in 1990, it suddenly resurfaced. It had been a really wet summer. It wiped out all the gypsy moth. We have not had an outbreak since 1990, and it's because of Entomophaga myrmica. It's not that there aren't gypsy moths around. They are. I see egg masses all the time. Yes, they defoliate small trees occasionally, but this fungus has controlled it.
Is that the same thing as the tent caterpillar?
No.
Oh,
related.
Okay.
It's related, but different. Okay, it doesn't make a tent.
Okay.
Okay.
Yeah.
But it is related in some distant, not even distant, pretty related. Okay.
Cool
different
thing.
Host.
Cool thing is that only one or two spores can produce thousands of spores on the insect when they sporulate.
So what you're seeing here is the fungus had originally gone inside it, and now it's saying, that insect is dead, I've eaten everything there was that I could eat, now I want to come back out. And so it starts finding exits in where there's little cracks and crevices in the body. Really cool. Okay, so now you're a little expert in insect pathology. Okay, so just so you understand how it works in terms of how you do research and how you develop fungi for this. So the first thing is to search for naturally occurring fungi. We've done that in China as well as around various areas in the Northeast and even a little bit farther south into Virginia. Found all sorts of fungi associated with it. You isolate it, you purify it, you identify it, and then you preserve it. We have a collection in our laboratory of over 2,000 isolates, not all from Hemlock Woolly Adelgid, but a lot of them are from Hemlock Woolly Adelgid. We test their ability to kill Hemlock Woolly Adelgid in the laboratory. We develop ways to mass produce them, and that's one of the things that's important. Remember, the cost for one beetle, one of those beetles that might kill a bunch of Hemlock Woolly Adelgid, are 70 cents to a dollar a piece. You can produce billions of spores on a grain of rice. And so they're very cost effective in terms of mass production potential. Okay, so then we test, the next step obviously is to test the how, yeah?
Are these fungi generalists?
Good question. Some are generalists, some are more specific. Like the fungus that kills gypsy moth, very specific to gypsy moth. The white stuff that you saw coming out of some of those other insects, that probably most of that was a fungus called Bovaria bassiana, which can be somewhat generalists. What we found in general is even though a fungus may be a generalist, oftentimes, depending on how you apply and when you apply the fungus, it doesn't have a serious impact on non-targets. But it's an issue that one has to think about for sure. I didn't put that in there, but you're right, that's important too. So then the next question is to test, assess their ability to stay, to persist in the environment when we're all gone. That's what's so cool about the entomophage of Myrmica, because it just chugs right along with the gypsy moth, because there always is that low level of population. Okay, so this shows, here's a plate with some fungi. This is what the spores look like. That's one of the ways you identify them. This is a Hemlock Woolly Adelgid with that same Bovaria bassiana coming outside of it. Okay, so now harnessing the potential. Now, you could say, well, let's just start spraying the fungus all over the forest. And if it's worked so well, and we did find fungi that were very effective at killing the insect. And you'll see a little bit of data on that. But hemlock is everywhere. It often occurs near wetlands. So the thought of spraying fungi all over the place, any more than spraying fungi, or spraying pesticides, it probably is not cost effective in the long run. So the ideal would be to somehow figure out a way, like with gypsy moth, that you could sustain the fungus in the population and hold it in check. So some foresters in New Hampshire noticed that this one forest had really high populations of Hemlock Woolly Adelgid, and they all died. And nobody knew why they died. You could see the carcasses of the insects. And so they brought it to us, and we were able to isolate a fungus consistently from these dead insects. And it was identified as Myriungium. And this is a known insect-killing fungus. And it had been found, this was in, 2006 or 7, I guess. So we had already found it in some of our other collections that we had done. So we knew that it occurred in association with Hemlock Woolly Adelgid. So we thought, so here's an example. Here's the settled. You see there's no white little halo around it. There's a healthy one with a halo. So that one was all dead. When we grew it on a petri dish, that's what it looked like. Consistently it grew that way, and there's little spores. Okay, so we took that fungus initially, figured out how to mass produce it. It's a little tricky to mass produce, I have to say. And these are some of our results. Now, don't get confused by this, and if I don't explain it, just tell me to do it again. Okay, so we tested the myriangium from Hemlock Woolly Adelgid. We also found myriangium from elongate hemlock scale, that other insect that often occurs in association with Hemlock Woolly Adelgid. So we did some work down in Vernon, Vermont, just a little bit further south from here. So we took samples in August 2011 before we sprayed. We did it 1 month later in September, and then we did it a year later. Okay, so what you see here is, I wish I had a pointer, but I don't. So you can see before we sprayed, this is percent mortality. You can see almost none of them were dead before we made the treatment. So that meant that they were a pretty healthy population. So we sprayed, and so this is the control. This is control where we did nothing. This is control where we just sprayed water. Again, this is myriangium, the spores in water, and this is the other strain. Because amazingly enough, even though they have the same name, these fungi, oftentimes they have very different characteristics. And you don't necessarily, you can't tell morphologically, you can't tell by the way they look whether they're going to be different or not. Anyway, so what you can see here is that indeed we were able to get 80, up to 80% mortality in the first year. Even a year later, we were still seeing lower populations than we had in the control. Okay, basically untreated. So we also looked in the spring of the year, and you got to remember the life cycle. So they go through the whole winter, they lay eggs, and then they start their population again. So what you can see, even in the spring, after the spray, you can see this is the number of Hemlock Woolly Adelgid eggs, these are that number of eggs, and these are the number of adults. So one of the things to keep in mind, the population was pretty low there, even in the plot, the trees that weren't treated. But look at the number of eggs that they were laying. So their ability to increase their population quickly is staggering. But look at that. Oh my God, we're so happy. And some of this is because we had killed them in September of 2011. So this is in the springtime. There weren't any adults left for them to lay eggs. So the population was very low. So hey, that's good, great, wonderful. So we got greater mortality from HWA, from spraying the fungi. Fewer eggs the next year, that's great, wonderful. Greater mortality of the settled after 1 year. And there was no difference between the two myriangium. Okay, well, so that's cool. So I'm just going to go. The thing that we found over time, though, was that we weren't, after this 1 year, we didn't see a carryover effect, that the population bounced back afterwards. So we weren't able, it wasn't persisting long enough to actually continue to suppress the population over time. Because fungi, the one problem with fungi, there's probably a few problems, but they don't like sunlight, and they don't like it too dry. Once they get in the insect, it's fine. But if they're just on the foliage of the needles, that's not so, they will not survive UV light. Yeah.
Is that a single spray?
Single spray, yep, one time. Yep, you're right. Okay, so we did some other work where we sprayed it twice. So you could do that, but keep in mind, that might work for a homeowner, but Forest and Parks is not going to have the ability to spray large areas. Plus the fact there's that whole issue of coverage. We're talking a great big tree there. How do you get fungi over a great big tree? Not an easy thing. So that's why you really want a fungus that somehow is able to move through the population. That is the one advantage of those super expensive beetles. They do have the ability to fly and to move from place to place.
So you could just spray the lower branches, if that's what you're saying? You
well, I would, so you'll get to see that in a little bit. I told it, don't forget the title. It's a hard nut to crack. Okay. How are we doing on time? What time is it?
8:15.
Okay.
We're going to go quickly now.
Okay, so the question that we have was, can we create a fungal epizootic like occurred in New Hampshire? That's what we really wanted to do. So we did some work at the World Center in Brattleboro. They had some nice hedgerow of trees, and we did some spray, and you can see the little spray thing. We sprayed individual branches, and I won't go into a whole lot of detail, but you can see some great mortality of the hemlock woolly adelgids. And compared to the red is the control where we didn't treat anything, and the blue is the treated. So yes, this fungus kills hemlock woolly adelgid. We could get a little bit of movement on the branch. Well, that's great. But darn it all, the population kept growing. And so far we have not been able to repeat that whatever caused that epizootic in New Hampshire, we don't know what it did. Now, like I said, with the gypsy moth, something snapped, something worked. Entomophagia came along and the conditions were right and it stuck within our system. We haven't figured out a way to make that happen with this fungus. Okay, so nature's complicated. What we found in our research in the last year or so now is, so we went back to some of these sites to look for differences in mortality, because that's, you know, are the insects getting killed? So what we found in some of the trials that we did is the hemlock woolly adelgid started dying, but not just in the treated branches, but also on the untreated branches. So obviously, something was killing them. This was the year before, the summer before, which was summer of 2013. So we took the dead insects back. We did all those isolations, and we found this funny fungus growing. It still has not been identified to species. We don't really know what it is. We can make it grow, not very fast. It's believed to be, I'm not even going to bother to say it, you can say it, Don.
Dothidiomycetes.
It's in that class, but we haven't gotten any further than that. And
well, it was sent to experts in Australia.
Yep, in Australia,
and they couldn't identify the species.
There is some DNA analysis work being done now. So it wiped out all of the hemlock woolly adelgid, whether it was treated with Mariangium or not. So I know that my sense is that, you know, we had a really cold winter in 2014. And everybody said, all right, hemlock woolly adelgid's going to be nailed. The population is going to be, you know, knocked back seriously. Now, what we know, and so we thought that too. However, we did know from the sampling that we had done that a lot of the hemlock woolly adelgid had already died in the summer before. So this was in the summer of 2013. They were already dead. So it didn't matter how cold it got, because a lot of them, the population had already dropped back incredibly. It was a real drag for our research. It made it very difficult to see differences because they were all dying. And so I believe that a lot of the mortality that was seen this spring that made people feel happy was not just because of the cold, and I'm sure the cold helped to kill a few more, based on some of the research that we had done before, but there also had been a serious drop in the population before. So you know what that does? When there aren't any pests, what does a tree do?
Synthesizes
invasives?
Huh?
That grows?
Yes, it starts growing all sorts really well. What we found is a hemlock tree that is heavily infested, it doesn't put on any new growth because it's just worn out, just like we feel when we get a cold. Oh, I'm not going to do anything. I'm just going to sit here and hope that it goes away. Now, that's not good for hemlock woolly adelgid. They love new succulent growth. They'll feed on the old twigs, the old tough twigs, but they really like the nice young succulent stuff. And I think in terms of their ability to survive is even better. So this is the other thing that we found. Okay, so this is population trends, and I know this is a little complicated, but this is previous year's growth. That's the old tough stuff. So this is the number of adults. This is the number of adults per 5 centimeter twig. So about that much twig. So we count all of the insects on those twigs, okay? So this is the number of HWA, number of live ones, okay? So you can see pretty low. This is in June of 2014, June 13, June 26, July 10, July 18, et cetera, et cetera. So what you can see is over time, the number of adults on the twigs goes down because they really like to go to new growth if they got it. Well, in this in these trees, there was all sorts of new growth. So they said, let's not worry about being on the old growth because it doesn't taste that good. We're going to move on to the new growth. So this is the second, when we start getting up here, this is that second generation. So these are probably primarily the first generation. This is the generation that made it over the winter. So you can see the population is quite low. There were a few crawlers, not very many. So the eggs that were laid, there weren't too many. And so they hatched and then they moved on. They moved over here. And you only see crawlers one time because that's when the crawlers were out. Then they move from being a crawler to being a settler, a nymph. So what you can see here is, oh my God, the ability of the hemlock woolly adelgid to bounce back, whether it's from cold or from a fungal infection, is incredible. And that's because they have 2 generations a year. And that's why knowing the life cycle is really important. If there was only 1 generation a year, it would take them much longer to increase their population. So, the take-home messages. Hemlock woolly adelgid remains a threat in our forest, rural, and urban settings, and it's not going to go away anytime soon, I don't believe. Cold winter temperatures are great for slowing the population down, but it's not going to stop it. And I think it's very possible that over time, the insect will develop tolerance to cold, potentially. So it's going to take a multi-pronged approach to actually try and manage this insect effectively. And that takes funding. And it is, just so all of you know, it is harder and harder and harder to get funding, whether it's from USDA or whatever. There's just incredible competition. There are so many agricultural problems going on that we spend way too much time writing grants to try and continue to do this kind of work. But I'm hoping, if nothing else, you realize how complicated it is to try and find a solution to an insect pest problem, especially in a forest. And there's just a couple of other things I wanted to say. Oh, I gotta say thank you to all these people, too.
Questions?
Okay, so thanks. This work would not have been possible without all sorts of support from Jim Esten. In case you don't know him, he has been critical to helping us find sites and working with homeowners, et cetera, et cetera. So, Jim, thank you very much, and your Forest and Parks crew. It's always a pleasure working with you guys. obviously, some of our funding has come from the Forest Service. We couldn't do it without them. We also have worked with several landowners and the World Center and Don, and all of those people have helped to make it possible to do.
Do you need world learning?
Pardon me?
Do you need world learning?
Yes.
Oh, is that what it's called? Sorry. We always call it the World Center. It's not called that. Pardon me.
A little hubris thing of us, isn't it?
What's that?
To call a little place like that the World Center.
I suppose. Oh, I don't mind. I think it's a pretty cool place.
I'm proud we're stuck on ourselves.
Now. So obviously, this is what we want. Not that, as much as possible. And I guess before I go to the questions, I wanted to say just a couple of things. There are new insects coming in all the time from exotic places. And we have to pick our battles. And Hemlock Woolly Adelgid is already here, and we still need to work on it, and it's obviously a really important problem. When I think of the threats to our forest, it's the Asian longhorn beetle that I worry about most of all. I know everybody's worried about emerald ash borer, and I understand that. That's a done deal. There is no reason to grow ash right now. I'm not saying you should cut it down, but I think it's only a matter of time before that hits here, and maybe some biological control agents will come along that will stem the tide, but I don't know. The Asian longhorn beetle, however, has a much broader host range and attacks so many trees that are so important to us. If you have to pick what insect you're going to look for and promote, to me, the Asian longhorn beetle has to be it. It has to be. And no offense to Jim, he cannot do it alone. Every infestation of the Asian longhorn beetle has been found by the general public, not by foresters. They can't do it. They can't be everywhere. So it's up to all of you to tell all of your friends that they need to be looking for it, because you never know where it's going to turn up. Just this summer, an area on Long Island, Islip, that had been determined, it had been claimed to be Asian longhorn beetle free probably 10 years ago.
10 years, yeah.
They just found it again this spring or this summer. Cut a whole bunch more trees down. So we have got to be vigilant for this one more than anything. And with that, I brought a bunch of bookmarks. It is a beautiful insect, by the way. Absolutely beautiful from an entomological standpoint. So for all of your Christmas presents or whatever presents, when you give books, or even when you don't give books, you could put it on the little card. You could put a little hole and give it to everybody so that they look for it. We get so many calls, and I know that the Forest and Parks gets hundreds of calls every year. And luckily so far, we haven't found the Asian longhorn beetle here, but it could come at any time. And early detection for this one is critical if we want to protect our forests and our cities and our urban, rural areas. I mean, it'll just wipe us out. They used to think that the Asian longhorn beetle would only be a problem in urban settings. They now have found in the Worcester area that, it does quite well integrating itself into the forest, into the dense forest. So our sugar bushes, everything, are really, truly at risk. So it's up to us all to be looking all the time for the rest of your life. And with that in mind, there are some, this is a host guide that we produced several years ago, and then it was renovated recently. And there's several copies, and you're free to take copies of them if you like. And I think that's all I have to say. Is there anything else I left out, Don?
I don't think so.
Okay. I did it by 8 o'clock, huh?
Yep.
All right.
The Asian longhorn beetle comes from Asia.
Yep. And Korea.
Is it not a threat to the native trees? trees there.
It is. It does cause problems in China. And I don't think they really have a solution for it, but their ecosystem is really quite different from ours in terms of, you know, they don't have a lot of forested land.
They're very dry.
Yeah, well, not only that, but, you know, they need all the land they can have for agriculture.
Yeah.
So they often grow hedgerows to protect their fields from wind, and those trees often are heavily infested. So my sense is it's not as severe, well, it's a problem probably is a matter of perception. So for us, especially, you know, in Vermont, when you think that every third tree is a host of this insect, plus there are all these others, they'll feed on a bunch of other things too. So it's hard to manage a forest to eliminate the problem. Like with the emerald ash borer, you know, I don't want to sound doom and gloom, but once all the ash trees are gone, they'll be sort of out of luck. Though I think there's a few other trees species they might go to, but this would be a smorgasbord. This our forest would be a smorgasbord for the Asian longhorn beetle, and so even though, you know, hemlock woolly adelgid is really important, especially to all of you down here, and it's important to us too. Everything we can do to keep the Asian longhorn beetle out should be done.
Question on a number of years ago, after 1988, because that's when I started working at World Learning and was driving the roads, but we had hemlock dying off, working its way towards us. I could see it from the school coming,
yeah,
you know, down in Guilford. Was quite bad. I was watching it come up the valley in New Hampshire, because I was in Vermont looking across and wondering, you know, when's it going to get to my house?
Yeah.
And then it stopped, and we haven't heard about that for, I don't know how many years.
So what you're saying is you're not seeing it spreading a whole lot within this area?
No, I mean, we saw it 20 years ago, and then...
But did you know, you didn't know it was hemlock woolly adelgid then?
No, I'm not saying it was. What was it?
I don't know. I don't know.
This was happening quite fast.
And before I came to work with the department, there was an outbreak in this area of hemlock loopers.
Oh, okay, that could be.
Okay.
Yeah.
Is the longhorn the one causing all the damage to pine trees in Florida?
No. And I don't, I suspect it might, is it a bark beetle, perhaps? I don't know specifically,
it's
but.
Southern pine bark beetle, perhaps.
Yeah, it could be.
It's devastating area.
Yep. Mm-hmm. So, you know, there's been all sorts of problems with bark beetles out west, and that's sort of resulted in a lot of the fires. And in that particular situation, some of the problem is production practices or farming or forest practices, that they grow all of the same type of tree, and so it's just perfect for an outbreak. I think in Vermont, we're much more careful about that. We have a more diversified forest, so that's less of an issue. But again, with the Asian longhorn beetle, because it has such a wide host range, it can't really be prevented by changing, you know, the planting practices.
I heard that, well, they told us that they release some fungi up behind the Dummerston Town Garage.
Yes, that was some of our work, yep.
And what was the result of that?
Well, again, so I think some of the, well, maybe I didn't include a graph of that. That was the year that this other fungus came in and really killed everything. This, whatever it is, this unidentified fungus. So it wasn't the fungus that we sprayed.
It wasn't the
though that thing. That, that killed them, but then this other fungus came in and was even more effective or more broad based. One of the things about research is it's kind of like medical research. You only know that a medicine works if you have a control that didn't have it. So that you can say, yes, when you don't take the medicine, then this happens, and when you do, you feel better. But in this particular case, something else totally different came along and killed Adelgids both in the treated and untreated. So our fungus may have killed a bunch of them, but this other fungus came along and killed the rest of them. So we can't really say what the effect of our fungus was. We can't say, yes, our fungus killed more insects than if we didn't spray it because everything died.
So we don't have a handle on that other fungus?
Nope. Or we don't know the identity. And it's still there, but based on the ability, based on the fact that the insect increased its populations this summer, suggests that it's not enough for probably all sorts of reasons that I don't know, whether it's because it was too hot or too dry or too cold or that's what makes it such a complicated thing. You know, that's why people love working with beetles, because they're bigger and you can watch them. You can see what they're doing. Even though they're very small, they're still really small, but not as small as the spore of a fungus.
Did you say they were working to identify the fungus in Australia?
Yes, we are. Oh. Well, we did. It was sent originally to Australia. Now we've sent it to someone in the U.S. that's going to do some more DNA analysis. Everybody talks about DNA analysis and how great it is. It only works if you have this thing called the gene bank, where all of the genetic information about all sorts of different fungi are stored. Well, if this fungus has never been found and analyzed by other people, then it's very hard to do any cross-referencing. It's all about comparing the genetics of these different things, and if you don't have anything to compare it to, then it makes it very difficult. There's just one other little thing. I didn't talk about it here, but although I did have some pictures of it. As you know, the emerald ash or the elongate hemlock scale is commonly found in association with hemlock woolly adelgid. There's some question about whether maybe the elongate hemlock scale finishes off the tree. The hemlock woolly adelgid weakens it, and then the elongate hemlock scale comes in afterwards and finishes off. There's different opinions about that, but one of the things that we found also, this is down in New York State, is that some of these areas where there was very heavy elongate hemlock scale, we found a fungus that was wiping that population out. We had hoped originally that maybe it would work against both insects somehow. So far, we sort of haven't been able to do that. But the cool thing about this insect, or this fungus, that we found associated with the elongate hemlock scale is that it's actually a plant pathogen that has changed. It's now its own species. It has a name that makes it sound like it is a plant pathogen, but it rarely infects to the point of causing damage on plants, but it kills the elongate hemlock scale. And so we'd love to test it more. We think that what's happened is that this fungus occurs inside the tree, and that when the insect, the scale, which has sucking mouthparts, sucks up the spores or somehow comes in contact with it and infects the insect. Cool, huh? Can we get funding from USDA to do that? We put in proposals again and again, and one of the problems is they say, hemlock. Who cares about hemlock? We care about corn, soybean, I don't know. There's a whole list of really important crops, cotton. from an economic standpoint, and I understand you got to set priorities, and USDA has to set priorities, and they would say, hemlock, yeah, cool. And the only way we can try and make an inroad in terms of making a justification for this is that maybe there would be ways to use this technology or this strategy of the fungus to on other plant systems. So far, we haven't been successful. I'm trying. But it's just fascinating that that's what it shows, how little we know about this natural world. And a scientist over in South Korea said, he works on bacteria in soil. He said 95% of the bacteria in the soil is not detectable. Because if you use usually you use plating, you use agar media. You put it on the agar media and the bacteria will grow. 95% of the species that are found in the soil cannot be found. So we don't have a clue what's going on in our soils. We only have scratched the surface, and I think probably that's true with fungi. We don't know what that insect is that was killing the hemlock woolly adelgid last year. We don't know if that is responsible for killing the population, or was there a whole nother fungus that we are not able to isolate using traditional methods. And so it's the more we know, the more we don't know, really. So it's exciting. Yes?
So is there, are people supposed to be reporting sites for when they discover HWA? This might be a question for Jim.
Sure.
Yes.
Yes. I've been working on that answer all night.
Because I think even though hemlock woolly adelgid will continue to spread, et cetera, I think the more that Forest and Parks knows where it is, the better it is. For a couple of reasons. One is for their database, but also when I have an opportunity to work on hemlock woolly adelgid, we don't have it up in the Burlington area, so that's why we come down here. I call up Jim. I said, Jim, we need this, this, and this. Do you know where we might be able to go? And really, all of the sites where we have done research, he has identified those. And so the more that he knows what's going on, the better. Yes?
Luckily, you can call, the extension office. And
yep.
Bill Guthrie will be up there that
yep.
evening to see it.
Okay. You're familiar with the extension? He's in the extension office.
Yeah, he's county forest.
Oh, okay, right. Yep. Yes.
So what can we do? There's people here that are representatives of the conservation commissions and just the public. What do you need from us? How can we be most helpful?
Well, that's an interesting question. You mean with hemlock woolly adelgid or in general? And anything.
In general.
Oh, man. knowing that you're willing to help goes a long way. There certainly are times when it really helps to have a letter from an organization like yours saying, we believe in this research and we want it done. Mm-hmm. So that's one thing, I suppose. I think, I don't like to dwell on the fact that funding is an issue, because really, you're here to learn about the insect, and I'm here to share that information. And I guess if nothing else, I would like you to go home thinking, God, this natural world is awesome. And the more that we look around, the better off we all are. And to realize how darn complicated it is. And so that's what I would hope. Because I think the more interested and concerned all of you are, the more that message will get out to other people. I'll just give you one little example. We've worked with greenhouse growers for a long time, and when we first started working, you know, 18 years ago, probably maybe 20% of them used some sort of biological control. Most people said, it's a cool idea, but it won't, I don't think it'll work for me. It's kind of expensive, and I don't have the time, et cetera, et cetera. And or they would say, oh, people don't like having biological control agents on the plants that they buy from our greenhouses. And so we did surveys, and we found out that a lot of people really didn't have that problem. There might be a few people that are a bit entomophobic, but generally speaking, people recognize there are insects in the world, and some of them will probably be on their crops. And it's been a transformation. And some of that has been pushed by the consumer. If the consumer is telling the greenhouse grower, I don't want plants that have pesticides on them, I'd rather have a few pests and a few biological control agents, that's going to help change how they do things. And I just, when I went to South Korea recently, I had to look up some information about pesticide use versus the use of biopesticides like fungi. I was shocked and appalled at the use of chemical pesticides in North America. It blew my mind. So I don't have the data with me, but I had no idea that billions of pounds of chemical pesticides that are still used today, probably not in Vermont, probably of all the states, Vermont is probably one of the lowest users. But boy, it made me think, I as a scientist and as an extension person, we need to be doing more, because that is not, it's not good for our environment. It's not good for us. And I think a lot of growers in Vermont get that more and more, and in New England. But the more that we promote that, the better.
A good example locally of what you're saying in use of biological controls is the Walker Farm.
Yes.
23 greenhouses. And Jeff Mannix is clearly moving in the direction you're talking
about. Yep. We've done a lot of work with him over the years. And you know what he's used to say to me? Oh, Art, thanks a lot for all the work you've done with me on using more biological control. And he's like, my God, it's really working. And it's mostly, he would spray chemical pesticides for western flower thrips, which is the insect that we've worked on primarily, because it has a very fast rate of reproduction and can cause all sorts of problems. And he said, you know, if there was a chemical pesticide, I think he wouldn't say this now, but back 5 years ago, he said, you know, if there was a chemical pesticide that I could spray once or maybe twice, and that would wipe out the problem, probably I'd still be using that today. But luckily, I guess, those pesticides started failing, because that insect had such an incredible ability to change genetically so that it became resistant. So you're right, but he is a great example. Paul Dutton is another one that we've worked with, who's really changed the whole way he grows his plants now. There's great promise and great hope, I think. But boy, is there a lot we still need to do.
So we need to do a lot of education.
Yes, exactly.
Is there a chance that these insects will, over time, develop some kind of resistance to the fungi that you're talking
Well,
about?
People always ask that. Will insects develop resistance to fungi? So we've seen examples of that with Bacillus thuringiensis, which is a bacteria that is also a microbial agent similar to fungi. In that particular case, because of the way it was used, I think, there are many many examples of insects that have developed resistance. Could that happen with fungi? I think it's possible. I think one needs to be creative about how one uses them. I think ideally, that's why, you know, that earlier slide talks about there's no silver bullet. There's no silver bullet for anything. And so even with the gypsy moth and Entomophaga myrmica, I think there may come a time when that will not be as effective. However, there are all sorts of other layers of biological control agents holding it in check. I think that's what has to happen with hemlock woolly adelgid. And fungi are just one part that is underutilized with this particular insect. So I'm less worried about that right now because fungi still remain so underused within agriculture in general. So I'm not too worried about it. Also, the thing about resistance is it usually occurs when the organism has one sort of mode of action, one way of killing the insect. And fungi have multiple ways of getting in, which will reduce its ability, reduce the potential of the insect to develop resistance. Yes?
We had an extensive monitoring program for hemlock woolly adelgid working with Jim. Is there something like that that is now underway or that we should be considering for Asian longhorn beetle?
Good question. I think there is some work, there are some first detector programs for the Asian longhorn beetle. Which, the trouble with the Asian longhorn beetle is it could be anywhere and nowhere. And so my feeling, this may be different from what Forest and Parks is doing. For me, just getting, especially for this insect, it's so big and so distinctive in the way it looks that it's just perfect for a public awareness program. And so, I personally, we're all busy people, so busy. So for me, what would work best for the Asian longhorn beetle is to get everybody knowing and to have everybody in this state to have a card or a bookmark on their refrigerator so that whenever they see something, that looks like the Asian longhorn beetle. It's been really gratifying. The minute we learned that the Asian longhorn beetle had been found in New York City and that its favorite host was sugar maple, we said, we need to get involved. And so we did a whole bunch of public awareness programs that went really nationwide. And we still get calls from people. Because I asked him, well, so how did you hear about the Asian longhorn beetle? Well, I got a card 3 or 4 years ago, and I always put it on the refrigerator door, and now I just saw it. And so I looked at the card, I looked at the telephone number, so I'm calling you up. And so just having people know what to look for, to me, is huge. That I'm not sure it's effective for people to be spending a lot of time going around the countryside looking for the Asian longhorn beetle, at least not right now, because the chances of finding it are so low, and it's hard to find it even on the tree, even in an area of infestation. That I can't remember what they were saying, but like 30 or 40% of the infestations go undetected on a tree, even though they know it's infested, they can't find it. So for areas like Vermont, it's going to have to be seeing the beetle, I think. You know, we get calls from people that have holes in their maples and stuff, but there are lots of other insects that cause similar holes. And so short of cutting that tree down, we really rarely can effectively tell what cause that. However, there is one other thing that's, let me see, I'm not sure. No, it's not on this thing, but it's in here. One of the things that is really distinctive and really odd about Asian hornworm beetle is the way they feed on the leaves, because the beetle comes out, the adult, and feeds on the leaves, and now I gotta find where this thing is. It is the bizarrest thing. And when you see that, it's a really, I should.
Page 21.
21, okay, I don't have my glasses either here.
Here.
Anyway, okay, good. So you can see it there. This picture, right, you don't all have it, but I'll pass it around. So they eat the leaf veins out and leave the, I'll just pass it around here. And that's not such a good example, but that's a good example. So see the, there you go, okay. So I don't know of any other insect that feeds like that. So one of the ways, again, so once you know what that is, so you're looking up just for fun, you're walking, you're taking a hike or whatever, you know, you don't necessarily have to say, I'm going out to look for Asian longhorn beetle today, and you start looking up. People are not going to do that. We're too busy. But if you have that in the back of your mind and you see something like that, or you see the beetle, that's when you make a call. And whether you call Jim or you call me, I don't care. Just call somebody.
It bumps me out that you don't get adequate funding, but it also disturbs me to still see pickup trucks of firewood going down the road with out-of-state plates. And why we don't have a little bit of public service announcements about that from time to time. You know, all these things are part of the same problem, but again, the Asian longhorn beetle is a lazy flyer, I understand.
Yep.
So how we transport things is important, whereas the emerald ash borer, a strong flyer, is going to get here eventually. If we could stop the Asian longhorn beetle and people moving firewood around, I think we'd be a long way ahead of the game.
Yep.
Massachusetts is going to start, what's the date today? What's the, today's?
Today's
18th. Oh, today's 18th, yeah. Well, yesterday they started a statewide quarantine for EAB, which should theoretically limit the movement of firewood out of Massachusetts.
Big sign on the interstate down there.
Really?
Oh, cool. Oh, cool.
So that's good. Still gonna get
going into Connecticut. Going south into Connecticut, there was a big sign about no. What was it about firewood? About
I think I saw that. Yes,
and that's a great way to do. Everybody's it's right in people's faces.
Yep.
Right, right there by the highway.
Yep.
Really great.
That's good
to get people.
So,
idea.
And it's not just Asian longhorn beetle and EAB. Firewood can have all kinds of pests in it that get moved around that way. It's a great way to move pests.
Just one other thing. Again, not to be all gloom and doom. You know, there are new exotic pests coming all the time, and it amazes me that some of them take care of themselves. And there's two examples in the recent past, and I don't think anybody knows why, but one of them is the viburnum leaf beetle. Are you familiar with that insect?
Mm-hmm.
A few years ago, and I don't exactly know when it was first detected here, it was wiping out all the viburnum. And I love viburnum. I love the smell, etc. And it was just decimating. They have two generations a year, I think. And so the first generation would come along, and they would defoliate it once. And then they would go into the soil, and the adults would then they would pupate and then come out in the soil. And the poor bunch would have just leafed out again, and bang, it would get them again. And usually it would only take 2 or 3 years, and then you'd have this big old dead viburnum bush. I don't know why, but for some reason it doesn't seem to be causing a problem anymore. There still are viburnum a few you know, maybe ones that happen to be more resistant, or there's some varieties that are more resistant, but something has come along to stabilize that, sort of like something that came along for the gypsy moth. Took a long time in the case of the gypsy moth, and probably entomophagia myga was originally brought in by scientists, but anyway, something clicked with the viburnum leaf beetle, and I'll probably be proven wrong next year, but it's been a couple of years that it doesn't seem to be causing a big problem. Another one is the lily leaf beetle. You're familiar with that?
Yes.
Bright red, beautiful insect.
Oh, the Asian lily beetle.
Yes. I mean, I stopped growing those beautiful lilies because what was the point? Because they would just look really bad. And so, I know, if you spray them, you could spray them and that would sort of work, but I don't have time to do that. I'm looking for the Asian longhorn beetle, you know? So last year, there weren't very many, and I talked to other people and they said, no, they didn't have very many either. Of course, a lot of people just pulled up their Asian lilies so they don't have anything anyway, but who knows what conditions made that happen. And potentially someday with hemlock woolly adelgid, that will happen too. But it's too late in Connecticut and Virginia and some of these other areas. Their forest ecosystem has changed. Now they've got burning bush growing under all over the place, because at least in part because the hemlocks have died and they've been outgrown by these other things. And so I'm not saying that we should just sit back and wait for nature to take care of itself, but I also don't want you to think that, I mean, we've got so much in this world that we can feel really sad about. So I don't want you to go home depressed. So with that in mind, look at that. Oh my God, I love traveling, but there's no place like home, and Vermont is, there's no other place as beautiful as Vermont, and I feel privileged to have grown up here and to be living here now, and still have a job that I love, really.
I know that this is going out way beyond our group tonight. It's on BCTV, and then people all over this area will be able to see it. People can download it from a website even anytime. You don't have to watch it just when it's showing, and it gets sent around the state, so it gets showed statewide on community television.